Good evening. Good evening. I'm John Meekum, I'm the executive director of the Union League Legacy Foundation, and it is a great pleasure to be back at the Union League at Torsdale after about a 2 year or so absence. We're back and we're really happy to be doing programs up here. I assure you it will not be two more years until we're here again. So welcome to tonight's Library Hour. The Legacy Foundation is a nonprofit charity of the Union League of Philadelphia. We use the history, the values, and that first line in your bylaws, every member shall support the Constitution and the free enterprise system, as the basis for all that we do, for our programs like tonight's Library Hour, for our civics education programs, our art conservation and house preservation, and for our scholarship programs. And all that is made possible through the generosity of our members. And for all of you that have contributed so generously over the last year, I appreciate it. And for those that haven't, I look forward to your support in the future, and you'll have plenty of opportunities to join us in the support of this great charity. A few housekeeping items, if I can. One is, please silence your cell phone, if you would. We will have a Q&A portion towards the end of the talk, and we are on Zoom and YouTube, so we're going to use microphones for all of the questions so our remote people can hear them. And so either Jim or I will probably have the microphones and we'll just come up and speak into the microphone. And remember, a question should be 2-3 sentences. It's not a speech. And if you've gotten to the end of your 2 or 3 sentences and you can't put a question mark at the end of it, you have failed. And we won't let go of that microphone, Jim, will we? So thank you. We do have a lot of upcoming programs. We have a busy fall scheduled, and we have schedules on all of the seats. I do want to mention to you our September 14th event, which is really a celebration and kind of welcome back and kickoff to the programming year. It's by invitation only. It will include the unveiling of our new portrait of Frederick Douglass. It's by invitation only, and if you haven't received an invitation, and you either think you should have, or maybe you don't know how you get one, please see our Director of Development, Krista Moran, who's right in the back there, and she will explain to you how to get an invitation to what should be a really, really exciting evening. And speaking of supporting the foundation, every year the Ladies Committee has a wonderful fashion show. I understand it's sold out, as it usually is, and they have a tombola. And the tombola, Babs, what do we raise? $30,000 for scholarship aid every year. And Babs, who is Babs DeLory, give a little wave, Babs, is chairing that. Thank you, Babs. And she's asking for your assistance in buying tombola tickets. So if you don't know how to do it, first of all, you just go online and look online. It's very easy to find on the Union League member website. But you could also talk to Babs. You could talk to Debbie over here. You could talk to Kristen and any of our other wonderful Ladies Committee members. So with that, I'm going to introduce the historian, the one, the only Mr. of the Legacy Foundation, the one, the only Mr. Jim Mundy, who will introduce our program. Jim.
Well, good to see everybody again now that we've all come out of the COVID caves. Well, welcome back. All right. Philadelphia is really a great place to look for authors. So that's why I think we're so fortunate to have Stephen here tonight. So Stephen Fried is an award-winning journalist and New York Times best-selling author who teaches at Columbia University Graduate School of Journalism and the University of Pennsylvania. He is the author of the historical biography Appetite for America, Fred Harvey and the Business of Civilizing the Wild West, One Meal at a Time. And does everybody understand the Fred Harvey reference? I mean, this is the generation that if anybody understands Fred Harvey, it should be you guys. Come on. Are you working? No? Okay. Remember the Atchison, Topeka, and the Santa Fe restaurants? You get off the train, you have a meal, you get back on the train. Very simple process. Great book. All right. And he also co-authored a book with Congressman Patrick Kennedy, A Common Struggle. His earlier books include the biography, Things of Beauty, The Tragedy of Supermodel Gia, and the investigative books, Bitter Pills and The New Rabbi. But this is the one I think we should really be talking about tonight. His most interesting book, I think, is perhaps called Husbandry, Sex, Love, and Dirty Laundry Inside the Minds of Married Men. Am I not right? Anyway, you can admit it, it's okay. Nobody will think any less of you. Okay, Our guest is a two-time winner of the National Magazine Award and has written frequently for Vanity Fair, GQ, The Washington Post Magazine, Rolling Stone, Glamour, and Philadelphia Magazine. He lives in Philadelphia with his wife, Diane Ayers. Diane, put your hand, yeah, there she is, okay. All right. And they live just blocks away from where Dr. Benjamin Rush lived. Although he originally lived way up here, just a few blocks from here, by the way, which is why we're here tonight. So, Stephen's Rush biography was the American Library Association Notable Book of the Year and was a finalist for the George Washington Book Prize. And on that note, it is my really great pleasure to introduce Philadelphia author and a very good Philadelphia author, Stephen Friedman.
Thank you very much. I have been giving a lot of Benjamin Rush talks from my house for the last year and a half. This is the first talk I've given wearing pants since February of 2020, I guess. So thank you for making me put on pants and leave the house. So Benjamin Rush is somebody that everybody should know. And not enough people do, but the founders would be in utter disbelief that especially we here in Philadelphia don't know that much about him. A lot of people have been talking about him lately. I would say that the pandemic has been a good time to be an expert on Benjamin Rush because a lot of people have been interested in the 1793 yellow fever epidemic and how it corresponds to what we've been going through recently, a lot more than we realize. And it's also been a time for endless writing about Benjamin Rush on the internet. So I spend a good amount of time every day trying to get people to stop posting this fake quote from Benjamin Rush, which has actually existed for over 100 years, in which in this fake quote, he says that medical freedom, which is, of course, a very charged word these days, should be in the Constitution. So Benjamin Rush never said this, never wrote it, but it's actually one of the most posted things about him on the internet. And I'm up on there so much that actually a local cartoonist made this cartoon of me playing whack-a-mole with people on the internet posting this Benjamin Rush quote. So, but here's something that Benjamin Rush did write, and this is my favorite Benjamin Rush quote. In 1786, Rush described the challenge of America as seeking perfection in science, religion, liberty, and good government. And this need to balance these things is as true today as it was then. The quote just keeps getting truer. I first learned of Rush in the 1990s when I was working at Philadelphia Magazine, and I covered the American Psychiatric 150th anniversary convention in Philadelphia. And I met him through this tote bag. I haven't chosen a lot of my book subjects by tote bag, but this one actually was a wise choice. So Rush is no longer on the American Psychiatric tote bag. So if you have one, you can hold on to it. So I was interested in Rush, one, because he lived down the street from me. And my wife and I both realized we had about a 10th grade knowledge of the American Revolution, everything Rush had been involved with. Everything that had been written about him was something that you would not read on purpose, even not for fun anyway. And his life, which is if you cover it properly, actually takes you through the entire period that when Philadelphia was the center of the universe. So the pre-revolutionary period, the revolutionary period, the period when the Constitution was written here, the period when Philadelphia was the capital from 1790 to 1800, and then Rush died in 1813. So he's a guided tour through a really different version of American history than we're used to seeing. We're used to hearing either the Virginia version of America or the Massachusetts version of America. So with Rush, it's almost like somebody was filming the entire revolution and they never developed the film. And so we get to see it. He's considered the founding father of American medicine and in mental health, the founding father not only of modern psychiatry, but also of clinical psychology and addiction care. He's also the landmark teacher of American doctors. He trained the first 3,000 doctors who became doctors in America. Wrote the core books and articles of American medical education. And he founded the first facility in the world for modern mental health care. But the other thing that you can see about Rush, since most of you don't know any of this, and I didn't know any of this, is that he had really bad publicists. So no musicals about Rush. And he would be amazed there's a musical about Hamilton, who he hated, and who thought represented sort of everything bad about America. But he was very close to Adams and Jefferson, Part of the reason you don't know about him is when he died, Adams and Jefferson wanted to make sure that his papers were suppressed because they knew he knows so much about them. And he had written they had written so many very personal letters to him. And he had written an autobiography that everybody was afraid would be published. So that's part of the reason why you don't know a lot of these things. But it's great stuff for a biographer jumping into the subject. So let's just start with what he looked like. So these are the two best-known images of Benjamin Rush. Interestingly, if you live in Philadelphia, you could have seen duplicate copies of either of them because there are many copies. Benjamin Rush was such a famous doctor that after he died, the alumni who had worked with him all wanted copies of his paintings. There's actually, within three blocks of my house, there are four copies of the one on the right, one at Pennsylvania Hospital, one, you know, they're just all over the place. But more interestingly, I think for us, we want to look at this picture. This is the earliest image of Benjamin Rush, unpublished image, published for the first time in the book. And the reason it's interesting is because part of what's cool about Benjamin Rush, I'm just going to wipe my brow repeatedly during this whole thing, and anybody else is free to drink water or almost pass out for the heat here. Is that Rush was younger than the other founders. He was, 30 when he signed the Declaration of Independence, and he was much younger than Adams and Jefferson and everybody else. And part of the reason that Rush was an interesting guy in Philadelphia was because he was sort of this precocious young genius. And he was known for having a very high forehead. And people said, he had so much in his head that it was sort of bursting out of his forehead. And he grew up in the suburbs, but his family moved into town when he was very young. His father, who was a blacksmith, died when he was five, and he was raised by a single mom who owned stores on Market Street. In the Market Street, she owned a china shop and a dry goods shop. He lived down the street from Benjamin Franklin, but never met him in America. He met him in England first, strangely enough. And part of the reason that his youth is important is because Rush was, his mother sent him to school, sent him to medical school. She insisted that he not marry until he was 30 and established in his business. So his youth is very important to us. And also he wrote a lot about his youth. So we actually know all about all his girlfriends, all the people he hoped he could marry, but his mom wouldn't let him. And you don't get a lot of that stuff in founding fathers. So we get to know Rush in a very personal way. And we get to know Rush in a very Philadelphia way, because again, the other major founders in Philadelphia weren't in Philadelphia for a lot of times of the Revolution. Rush is here, except for a very short time. So Rush goes to boarding school in Maryland. His mother gets to send him. He then decides to become a doctor. He trains in Philadelphia. This is when there is no medical school in Philadelphia yet. He trains with John Redman. And then during the time he's training in the 1760s, these two gentlemen return from their educations in Edinburgh, which was at that time the center of the intellectual universe. This is the height of the Scottish Enlightenment. And the top medical school in the world was in Edinburgh. So John Morgan and William Shippen were the first two doctors who taught medicine in Philadelphia, and Rush was their first student. Shippen taught anatomy and midwifery, and much to his astonishment, did not start the first medical school in the country. His friend John Morgan came back after him and did start the first medical school at the College of Philadelphia, which was the school that Benjamin Franklin started. And because they were not named as co-founders, they fought about this for the rest of their lives. This wouldn't normally mean much, just like two Philadelphians being pissed off at each other, except if you know your revolutionary history, you know that John Morgan and then William Shippen ran all the hospitals for the Revolutionary War. So they were always at each other's throats. George Washington could not believe how mean Philadelphia doctors could be to each other. And Benjamin Rush was caught in the middle of them for his whole professional life, which is part of the reason why he fled. And these are, actually, this time you bought tickets to individual lectures. You went to them, and then at the end of the semester, you had a little meeting with the doctor, and he decided whether you passed. So these are actually Rush's tickets for his two doctors. He decided to go to the University of Edinburgh himself. He studied there with William Cullen, who was the most famous doctor in Edinburgh during that time. This is also when he met Benjamin Franklin. Benjamin Franklin lived in London at this time. So even though Rush lived down the street from Franklin, he had never met him. So he met Franklin while he was training. Franklin wrote him letters of introduction to basically every cool person in England and France. So all the books that he had read, all the literature that he had read, if any of those writers were still alive, Franklin arranged for him to have dinner with them. He saw the world from a whole different perspective. He studied in London and in Paris. And then he came back to be a doctor in Philadelphia. And he taught chemistry because that was the only job he could get. So he was the first professor of chemistry in America at the College of Philadelphia. And he started teaching in the fall of 1769. So at this time, this is what Pennsylvania Hospital looked like. It's really hard to imagine this today, but there was Pennsylvania Hospital and then there were fields. Because that's how far Philadelphia only went to Pine Street at that time. It only went from the river to like 8th or 9th Street, Pine to Arch. That was the whole city. So Rush learned there. This is the front of Pennsylvania Hospital, the 8th Street entrance, which is still that way. And he struggled to start a medical practice because he realized very quickly he was the wrong religion. So part of the reason that Rush was so interested in separation of church and state was because as a second Presbyterian, he felt that it was very hard to start a practice in a city that was mostly Quaker and Church of England. And Presbyterians, first Presbyterian was actually much bigger. So he had a difficult time starting practice. He worked a lot in underprivileged communities. This is a time, by the way, that hospitals were only for poor people. All medical care was done in your house. So Rush with all house calls, and he had patients of all races, all religions. And then finally, in order to get, and many of them didn't pay. So some of them paid in chickens, and some of them, you know, just did favors. And so in order to get slightly better paying customers, he wrote this pamphlet. It's called Sermons to Gentlemen Upon Temperance and Exercise, which is the first self-help book. And it basically tells you how to exercise, how to take care of yourself, how to eat better, all these things that we take for granted. And we also think we're invented during our lifetime. In fact, Petros was talking about them in the 1700s. My favorite part of this book is his writings about temperance. So temperance at that time, just so you know, didn't include wine and beer. Because wine was medicine and beer was, there was nothing wrong with beer. So this is what Rush wrote in his book about temperance. One of my favorite Rush quotes: wine is principally useful to old people and such as are in the decline of life. At a medium, the body begins to decline at the age of 45 or 50. Then the hot fit of the fever of life begins to abate, and from the many disappointments in love, friendship, ambition, or trade, which most of men meet by the time they arrive at this age, they generally feel a heavy heart. Here wine prolongs the strength and powers of nature. It is the grave of past misfortunes. In a word, it is another name for philosophy. So remember, my aged hearers, if you would expect to enjoy a long reprieve from the infirmities of age, you must begin to use wine moderately and increase the quantity of it as you descend into the valley of life. So we should all have a doctor who gives us this advice. Interestingly, and I never get to use this slide, but I get to tonight because I'm here. This book also is the first time that anybody in America wrote about golf. So Rush knew about golf from Scotland. Golf was not played in America. This is an ad from Time Magazine during the bicentennial, which they quote Rush saying, a man who played golf would live 10 years the longer. And this is actually from, you can't read this, but this is from this book, this pamphlet that I'm telling you about. He talks about what golf is like. He says, played with little leather balls fluffed with feathers, and flicks made somewhat in the form of a bandy wicket. He who puts a ball in a given number of holes and the fewest strokes gets the game. So this book was really, this pamphlet was very interesting. And what it led to was another pamphlet that was much more controversial. So in the pamphlet, he mentioned that part of the reason people had to exercise was because they had slaves doing all their work. And that if they did more physical exercise themselves, that would be good because slavery was horrible and they should. The leading abolitionist of the day, Anthony Benezet, saw this and asked Rush to write a pamphlet against slavery. This pamphlet came out, people don't know about this, in 1773. It is the first important pamphlet, certainly the first one written by a founder, about slavery. It totally is against slavery. It also raises issues of racism against free blacks, which is another issue at that time. Philadelphia was had a large free black population. Rush was very concerned about that level of racism for blacks who were already freed. And so by publishing this book, he lost half his patients overnight. And because of that, we think that is probably the reason that he did not write Common Sense. So you may not know this, but Common Sense began as a pamphlet that Rush was writing. And then Rush realized he had already lost so many patients writing about abolitionism that he decided to find a local freelance writer whose career, if it was destroyed, it wouldn't be so bad. So he met Thomas Paine, who's a young writer in town, and he shared what he was writing, and Thomas Paine then wrote the pamphlet. Rush edited it. We have documentation of Paine coming to his house. He would read it, and then Rush titled it. It was originally called something else. Rush had it published. None of them, of course, had any idea what it would become. It was just a pamphlet about independence. At this time, it came out in January of 1776, and it came out at a time when Rush had many more important things on his mind because he had finally turned 30 and he could get married. Common Sense came out the day before his wedding. He married Julia Stockton, the 16-year-old daughter of Richard Stockton, who, of course, you all know from the Turnpike rest stop. If you know more about Richard Stockton, you know that his family founded Princeton University, gave the land for Princeton University, and he was at this time the most important lawyer in New Jersey. He was married to Annis Boudinot, who was actually from Philly, and was part of the ladies' writers group in Philadelphia. There was a great writing group of women in Philadelphia, and Annis was part of that. She was one of the first published poets in America. And Julia was their oldest daughter. She was also a very talented musician. But even though she was 16, she was very smart, very well-read, and Rush was quite the feminist. So we actually have their love letters. They were given to the Rosenbachers. And in them, you know, Rush is a very good love letter writer. But he also talks about the kind of ambition he has for their marriage. He actually lists in one letter that he's building her a library in the bedroom of their house. And he lists the first 100 books he has bought her that she can read and they can discuss. So this is a very modern romance, fascinating couple. I always think of the Adamses and the Rushes as being the only real love matches among the founding fathers. And that's why they were close friends. So they got married. Rush was at this point, he was a doctor who took care of people who were in town for the Continental Congresses, but he did not have political responsibility. He got involved with the writing of the Pennsylvania Constitution. You have to remember during this time, states were much more important than federal government. The federal government didn't exist. Pennsylvania was one of the, if not the most important states in all of this. And Rush was involved with the writing of the Constitution. He was outraged the Pennsylvania Constitution had a religious clause in it that actually said that if you didn't say that you believed in Jesus and that you believed the Old and New Testaments were absolutely true, then you could not run for office in Pennsylvania. Which Rush was in a funny position because he believed these things himself, but he was outraged that somebody would think that this should be in the Constitution. And that put him on the wrong side of Pennsylvania politics, but eventually John Dickinson refused to sign the Declaration of Independence, and Rush was put in his place, and he signed the Declaration. So he had been in the Continental Congress for 2 weeks before he signed the Declaration of Independence. We're lucky that he did because he's a really good writer. He wrote great stories about what it was like to sign the Declaration. He described the darkness and quietness in the room, how freaked out everybody was, but he also told funny stories about it. One of the things he told in his diaries was that during the signing, Benjamin Harrison, who was a big heavy representative from Virginia, and Eldridge Gerry, the founder of gerrymandering, a skinny guy from Massachusetts, approached the sign. And Harrison apparently said to Gerry, he said, you know, when we are hung for signing it, I'm going to die right away because I'm a big fat guy. And you are skinny and you're going to dangle for a really long time before you die. So these are the kinds of things they were talking about during this time. So Rush became a member of the Continental Congress, became friendlier with Adams and Jefferson, became friendly with Washington, very supportive of Washington. He also, at a certain point in the fall of 1776, left Congress to go be on the front lines with the troops. He wanted to take care of them. He wanted to be a doctor. So that's why he was with Washington the night before the crossing of the Delaware, So many of our descriptions in history books come from Rush's diaries, because Rush was a very vivid writer. So the description you've seen in almost every history book of Washington writing victory or death on little pieces of paper, that's from Rush's diary. So Rush saw him, he sent Rush back with orders, and Rush went to the Pennsylvania delegation. So the Washington's group got across first, Rush's group came later. Rush was there to take care of patients at the Battle of Trenton, and then he followed the troops to the Battle of Princeton. So he had gone to Princeton, and there he was taking care of people in front of the building, Nassau Hall, where he had been a student. And one of the people he took care of was General Mercer, who we see being stabbed. So General Mercer was somebody he had just met, and Mercer surrendered, and the British killed him anyway. Or they tried to kill him. They beat him over the head. They stabbed him 7 times. And then Rush had to take care of him. And we actually have their doctor-to-doctor conversations. Mercer's pretty sure he's going to die. Rush very optimistically thinks he's going to live. Mercer is right. And you can still go to the house right there in front of Nassau Hall. You know, that house, you can still see the bloodstains on the floor from Mercer bleeding out. Here's another image from that time period. That's Rush above Mercer. And that's Washington. So these are the kinds of instruments that Rush worked with at the time. Obviously, medicine was very primitive. A lot of sawing, a lot of bloodletting, a lot of purging. And Rush was very traumatized by being on the battlefield. He wrote about what it was like. I mean, he described people coming in with a cannonball had blown off somebody's hand, that it was just hanging by a sinew. So he was traumatized by this. And the earliest writing about PTSD is really his writing about this. And he ended up writing, inspired by this and freaked out by this, the first major piece on war medicine. And its first line is actually one of the most famous lines in the history of medical writing. Fatal experience has taught the people of America the truth that a greater proportion of men perish with sickness in all armies than fall by the sword. This was written because the Rush was voted out of office right after the Battle of Princeton because he didn't support the Pennsylvania Constitution. And he was made the Surgeon General of the Middle Department, which was where all the fighting was going on during the war. And he, his wife was sent away. She was pregnant. She was sent to Maryland so that she wouldn't get hurt. And Rush was on the front lines for a year. So during that time, he was at the Battle of Brandywine, which, if you know, was like one of the worst battles ever. He was actually stuck in the middle of the worst part of it. I'm not going to try to point with this because I'll screw it up. So the blue is our side. The red's their side. And Rush was there where it says Birmingham Meeting House. That's where the hospital was set up. So Rush was taking care of patients. They laid the doors down over the pews. And of course, they didn't know that half of the British people were going around and coming to sneak behind, but they attacked the Birmingham Meeting House before they attacked Washington's troops. So Rush and other doctors were taken prisoner. We don't really know how they got out, but they did. This is one of the worst defeats, and it led to many other terrible defeats during that fall. So Rush and everybody else in America was really freaked out that we were going to lose. And he also felt that Washington was not putting enough money into medical care. So he started writing Washington letters. And he knew Washington well, and he was freaked out that Washington was not writing back to him. At this time, the Continental Congress had left Philadelphia and was in York. And Rush, who had a bit of a mood disorder, we believe, was getting really manic. You can tell from his writings. And he's listening to a lot of generals who were telling him that Washington had made bad choices and that we were going to lose because he had made bad choices. So he was telling these stories to other people. He sent a letter about this to Adams. He sent a letter about this to his wife. And he sent this letter to Patrick Henry, who he knew because he had actually inoculated Patrick Henry. And it just repeated what he had been hearing from the generals, that Washington was, you know, sort of screwing up and we were losing. And he told Pat, this was not a signed letter, and he told Patrick Henry to burn it after he got it. Patrick Henry did not do that. In fact, he held on to it for the next 2 months. Rush wrote another letter about this to his wife, which we found at the Rosenbach, actually. And eventually, Washington wrote back to Rush, agreed with all the changes that Rush wanted, and things were going to be fine. Except William Shippen was tired of Rush having standing with Washington, said to Washington, you have to pick either me or Rush. They picked Shippen. Rush was sent home. And then Patrick Henry gave Washington the letter. So months later, and that letter destroyed Rush's relationship with Washington. Washington never forgave him for writing a letter criticizing his generaling during, you know, this is during Valley Forge, this is during a very dark time in American history. So the two of them had a lot to deal with for the rest of their lives. And in fact, the fact that Russia criticized Washington hung over his legacy after he died. It is part of the reason you don't know very much about him, because the family was afraid for his story to be retold because they thought that the story of him criticizing Washington would be retold. So Rush went home and he started his life over. This right after the British left Philadelphia. He started being a doctor again. And he became a writer about what America was supposed to be after we won. And his writing about what America is supposed to be, what an American citizen is supposed to be, and what we're supposed to do with all this freedom that we get is actually unbelievably interesting and really sets a stage. You know, he wrote, "The American War is over, but this is far from being the case with the American Revolution. On the contrary, nothing but the first act of the great drama is closed." And that was a theme of a lot of his writing after that. What are we going to do to be worthy of this freedom? So the first thing he cared about was education. He believed in equality of education, equality in religion. And so he started Dickinson College. So Dickinson College was the first non-urban college. So Rush started that in Carlisle, which was the end of the universe at that time. He also started Franklin College, which became Franklin and Marshall. And that was a German-only college, because at that time he believed that German immigrants who did not speak English deserved an education as well. And he started writing incredibly famous pieces as he was growing as a doctor. He wrote a treatise on female education because he was involved with the first public school for women, which taught a curriculum very similar to what was taught to men. He wrote a very important plan for public schools, which was the first plan for public schools, which was used all over the country. And he started writing medical treatises that were important. The first one he wrote was about the effects of spirituous liquors on the human body, because he was now on staff at Pennsylvania Hospital, and more than half of the people in the hospital were there because of alcohol. So it was very important to him. He believed that alcoholism was a disease. This is a time when medicine was trying to be separated from the church, and we are trying to do something, which unfortunately we are still trying to do today, to get people to understand that mental illness and addiction are not because of weakness or lack of faith, but they are medical illnesses. Rush believed this, and he had the same hard time convincing people of that then that we sometimes have convincing people of it now. He wrote this treatise, and then he wrote this, "An Inquiry and the Influence of Physical Causes on the Moral Faculty." This is the basis of our ideas of mental health, of our modern ideas of mental health care. So this is the first treatise in which somebody lays out and says, mental illness is a disease. It is a medical problem. It is not because of lack of faith. It is not because of lack of will. Benjamin Franklin, to whom this was dedicated, was a little freaked out by this. This was presented at the American Philosophical Society. Most people in mental health care don't understand what this is, because these ideas were lost. But in fact, these were the ideas that governed mental health care at Pennsylvania Hospital during this time, and why people came to study with Rush. Because just so you know how mentally ill people were treated before this, Pennsylvania Hospital didn't believe that mentally ill people could feel hot and cold. So there was no heat in the basement cells where people with mental illness and addiction were. You could also come and pay to see the mentally ill people. That was part of the way the hospital made money. So Rush banned all this. He forced the hospital to build heat in there, and then he forced them. We don't really think of it this way, but so we all know the 8th Street entrance to Pennsylvania Hospital because that's what we know. Rush forced them to build the building on 9th Street, which we don't even deal with anymore. It's mostly an office building. But in its day, that was the first building in the world that was built in a city to give modern mental health and addiction treatment. That's why Rush had it built. So this is a very fascinating time in medicine and in public health. This is the beginning of American public health. This is when the Philadelphia dispensary is created, which is the first walk-in clinic for people to get care. It was put together by the church and by Rush and other doctors. And this is also when the Abolition Society comes back. So the Abolition Society had existed a little bit before the war, and then it slowly came back after the war, 1787, when Ben Franklin returned. And Rush and Ben Franklin ran it, and that's when it became important. Oddly enough, for somebody who's a lifelong abolitionist, Rush owned one enslaved person, a man named William Grubber, a cook and Rush owned him, we believe, from 1780 through the early 1790s when he was freed. These are actually his manumission papers. This is very confusing. A lot of things about Benjamin Rush can be confusing. He's not a perfect or simple guy. So these are the papers surrounding that. And at the same time, of course, he's working for the Abolition Society. He's working for the Free Black Society. He's helping free blacks in Philadelphia who want to start their own church because they're being discriminated against in the white churches. He is not involved in the writing of the Constitution. I just put this there because the Constitution happened during this time. The lobbying that he did was mostly about separation of church and state issues, which he did with Jonas Phillips, who was the president of Mikveh Israel, which was the first Jewish synagogue in Philadelphia. Phillips is really the one who's mostly given credit for that language being in the Constitution. And during this time, John Morgan died. Rush became the most important doctor in Philadelphia, and he started writing his first medical book, Medical Inquiries and Observations, many versions of which came out. And he also did much more lobbying to get the Pennsylvania Hospital to do more and more for mental health care. So in the middle of all this, Rush is rising as a doctor. He's now Philadelphia's most important doctor, most important teacher of medicine. All of a sudden, Philadelphia becomes the U.S. capital, which really kind of was a surprise. Philadelphia had lost the capital, its capitalness, because of arguments about the Continental Congress. There basically had been fights over payments for people in the war, and the capital had moved all over the place and had ended up in New York. Alexander Hamilton made a deal that the capital would end up eventually in Washington, in D.C., a slave state, and the compromise was that Philadelphia would be the capital for 10 years. So Philadelphians don't know this story very well, but it's actually quite amazing. There are 10 years that changed the world, and part of the reason we don't know that much about it is because all the founders didn't write any letters during that time because they were here. I mean, it's not that they didn't write any letters, but compared to the amount of correspondence that existed between them when they were in their own cities as opposed to when they were all in Philadelphia. It's not as well documented as it could be, but it's utterly fascinating time. And this is when Rush became incredibly famous all over the country. He was known as the American Hippocrates, which was a compliment from some people and a criticism from other people. And one of the people that criticized him was Alexander Hamilton. So I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on Hamilton. We could hiss Hamilton. I believe in hissing Hamilton. I mean, really, any musical that says that New York is the center of the universe during the Revolutionary War, I mean, come on, where are the fact checkers on Broadway? So Hamilton, interestingly, was Rush's neighbor. You can actually see on the right, this is the census, and you see it says Dr. Benjamin Rush right here. When Rush moved, the Hamiltons moved into Rush's house. The wives were friendly. We now know that Hamilton's wife needed a friend. The kids were friendly, but Rush and Hamilton really did not like each other. Rush basically saw Hamilton as sort of a bomb thrower. Rush was in the Federalist versus Republican debate much closer to Jefferson than what Hamilton had in mind. And he basically felt that Hamilton was trying to politicize everything. So if we think that all the sort of the deep politicization of American life only got invented in the last like 3 or 4 years, you should read the newspapers at this time because people were complaining about this then. And it really started the minute America started. And Rush was very upset about that. And he thought that Hamilton was to blame because Hamilton politicized everything and made everything Federalist or Republican. So these are obviously the buildings where all this stuff was going on, Congressional Hall next to the Independence Hall. And this is the time when Penn consolidated and became a much bigger school. So the College of Philadelphia had gone through various versions. It all was consolidated into the University of Pennsylvania in 1791. And Rush was the god of the University of Pennsylvania. He was, you know, the leading intellectual. He was a signer of the Declaration. He was a public philosopher who was read in America and in Europe. He was a really big deal. He started giving introductory lectures every year to the beginning of the school year, which ended up becoming a very important book. He was the god of medicine in America. And then yellow fever came. So I could give you a whole other lecture on yellow fever, but I will spare you. I will only say this. Bloodletting was not invented for yellow fever. Benjamin Rush didn't invent bloodletting. Every treatment that was done during the yellow fever epidemic didn't work. Nobody was right. A lot of people died. Most of the things you know about yellow fever were not reported during yellow fever. They were reported by political writers years after yellow fever to attack Rush and to attack Adam and to attack Jefferson. There were writings in the paper after the epidemic that Rush killed everybody and that in fact yellow fever hadn't hurt anyone. It was all Rush's bleeding. The politics of this are horrible. They are exactly like today. When you don't have enough science, politics comes in. And when you look at what happened during yellow fever and you look what's been happening during coronavirus, it's so similar, it's amazing. There is alternative press that is making everything into a political problem. It's really bad. It's also a very heavily racial time because Rush asked the leaders of the Black church to help him in caring for people in Philadelphia because so many white doctors had left town. They did an admirable job. And then afterwards, when they were written about, they were criticized for robbing white people and for treating them badly, which is horrible, but also led to the first ever book written by African Americans and copyrighted by African Americans. So the writing after the yellow fever epidemic is fascinating, mostly for this book, Narrative of the Proceedings of Black People During the Late Awful Calamity in Philadelphia in the year of 1793. This book goes into incredible detail about what it was like to be black and trying to help white people during the yellow fever epidemic. And it ends with an essay confronting people about why they are racist, which is still fascinating today. This is something that both Richard Allen and Absalom Jones, the leaders of this, and Benjamin Rush wrote about all the time. They wanted to try to confront people. Why are you racist? What do you think you know that other people don't know that allows you to be racist? Rush believed that black people were the same as white people. They just had darker skin. He was regularly criticized for this. After the yellow fever epidemic, they finished what ended up becoming the first two black churches, Mother Bethel AME Church at 6th and Lombard, and the Church of St. George, which was then at 5th and St. George, right around the corner from it. It's now in the suburbs. But these were the first free black churches in America and unbelievably significant, and they were started basically by Jones and Allen and Rush and the other people that Rush encouraged to raise money, to get involved. Rush even edited the sermon for the first Sabbath service at the Church of St. George. This is the time when Rush had the West Wing of Pennsylvania Hospital built for more care of mentally ill people. He had an amazing time during the 1790s because his two best friends in the Revolution were in town. He saw them all the time, even though he was caught in the middle of them because they were politically on opposite sides. It was a fascinating time. He talked about science and religion with Jefferson all the time. The Adamses and the Rushes were like couple friends. You can see in Abigail's letters, Holmes like, thank God we know the Rushes. Like, they know everybody. They know like the best cleaners. They know the best restaurants. So it's really fascinating relationships between all of them. As the country is devolving into this incredible fight after Washington isn't president anymore because, you know, the Adams-Jefferson election in 1796 is rough and the Adams-Jefferson election in 1800 is horrible. I mean, it's so much like the election we just went through that you can't believe it. The press is so mean. Everybody wants to kill everybody else. It almost seems like America that we already blew it. And some of the founders start talking about this as if we've already blown it. And Rush was caught in the middle of this. After the election, Philadelphia wasn't the capital anymore. It also wasn't the capital of Pennsylvania anymore. So it went from being the most important city in the country in every possible way to not even being the capital of Pennsylvania. And this is the world that Rush inherited. Now, Rush was, of course, one of the few living founders at this point. He was, you know, a great hero of the Revolution. But he was crushed. This is what America had come through. So after the election of 1800, he didn't speak to Adams for 5 years. And Adams didn't speak to Jefferson for 12 years. And Rush was so despondent by what had happened in politics that this is what he wrote in his autobiography to his kids to beg them not to get involved in politics. In battle, men kill without hating each other. In political contests, men hate without killing. But in that hatred, they commit murder every hour of their lives. And he was so worried, as were many of them, that politics and partisanship had already destroyed what they had created not that long ago. It hangs over every aspect of American life. During this time, he was still in touch with Jefferson. Jefferson actually made him the medical advisor to the Lewis and Clark expedition. Lewis came to Philadelphia to study with him. He gave him ideas about what questions he should ask the Native Americans when he was out there. He also gave them drugs. And of course, all the big treatment was mostly purging. So he gave them purgatives that had mercury in them, which was, you know, one of the standards of the day. And the only good thing about having mercury go through your system is that you can find mercury when you go out searching. So part of the reason that we know where Lewis and Clark went on their expedition is because we actually know where they went. And we can follow them through the mercury that came through them. Not what Rush was planning on, but that's what happened. And so Rush was, you know, this famous doctor. He was running the medical school. And then in 1805, Adams sent him a letter, and he said, you know, we should actually have a conversation before one of us drops dead. And this set off this amazing correspondence, which I have to say took over the entire last quarter of my book because I found it so riveting. These guys never saw each other again, but they wrote endless letters to each other about everything. These letters are so emotional. They relive the entire American Revolution. They relive their entire personal lives. The families sit around and read them around the campfire, you know, because they're so interesting. One of my favorites, you know, one of the things that both Rush and Adams were obsessed with was fame. So, you know, because we didn't have a king anymore, they were fascinated by how fame had already become an important thing in America because we did not have royalty. So they were both shocked at how much fame mattered, and they were really pissed that they weren't as famous as Washington and Franklin. So this is something that Adams wrote, that he wrote this to Rush a number of times. This is my favorite version of it. The history of our revolution will be one continued lie from one end to the other. The essence of the whole will be that Dr. Franklin's electrical rod smote the earth and outsprung General Washington. Franklin electrified him with his rod, and thenceforward these two conducted all the policy negotiations, legislation, and war. So they could not believe that the two dead founders who were so famous were so much more famous than them. These letters are epically cranky, but they're also fascinatingly human, and the wives were utterly fascinated by this. I mean, Abigail thought that the letters kind of kept John Adams alive because John Adams was really depressed. Rush's wife Julia once wrote that these letters seem less like the letters of founding fathers and more like the letters of teenage girls talking about their boyfriends. But they are amazing, and they retell the entire history of the American Revolution. They also tell the tragedies of the family. Rush's oldest son, John, and this is our only image of him, a doodle that Rush did of him, because John, who was a doctor, went mad after shooting his best friend in a duel on a Navy ship. He was a Navy doctor, and Rush had to treat him, and Rush failed. And he ended up spending the next 35 years of his life in Pennsylvania Hospital. This is actually his admission record. You can see right there, admitted John Rush, melancholy. This was very powerful for Rush. He couldn't believe that he couldn't treat his own son. Adams had lost a son to alcoholism, so these issues were very important to them. This is also when Rush convinced the Adamses that Nabby Adams needed to have surgery on her breast cancer, which unfortunately they caught too late and she died. So this correspondence is amazing. And at a certain point, what it becomes about is that Rush feels that if he can't get Adams and Jefferson to be friends again before one of them dies, the history of America will never be right. But these guys basically invented America. And if they were their friendship was destroyed by partisanship, that's the end of America. And so he starts writing to both of them, trying to convince them to be friends again. This is like high school letters. You know, Adams still likes you. I mean, really. Adams still loves you. He writes to Adams and said he had a dream last night, and in the dream, his son was reading to him from a history book from the future, and in the history book from the future, it says that next week, Adams and Jefferson started writing to each other, and they all made up and were happily ever after. This went on for over a year. They were older than him. He thought one of them was going to die. In January of 1812, Adams finally wrote to Jefferson, and their renewed correspondence went on, of course, as you know. They died in 1926, so they lived another 13 years, and they rehashed the entire American Revolution as well, and John Quincy Adams and Rush's son Richard was also part of this conversation. The last thing Rush did, because he got ill during this time, was he wanted to write the first American book on mental health, which he did. It came out in the fall of 1812. This is actually the copy that he signed to John Adams. Adams said this book was brilliant and no one was going to get it during their lifetime. And he was right. Rush died in April of 1813. A newly found letter to Abigail from his wife describes his death much differently than it had been described in the history books before. And he was arguing with his students, because all his former students were taking care of him. He wanted to be bloodlet. He's still like, cut me, Mick, you know. Too many Sixers games when I saw that. So he wanted to be bloodlet. His wife finally said no more bloodlet, you know, and he died. This is his grave. It's right around the corner from where Benjamin Franklin's grave is. And the minute he died, his legacy was put into controversy because his son Richard was in politics at this point, and he was afraid that some of the things his dad had written would hurt him. Because his dad had written an autobiography, a handwritten autobiography for his kids, in which he basically part of it's like a burn book, where he writes about what he thinks of every person who signed the Declaration of Independence and every general, and some of it's really mean. He also just was very open about a lot of things about the Revolutionary period. And he also had all these letters from Adams and Jefferson that Adams and Jefferson were really scared would come out. Some of the letters from Jefferson talked about his concerns about religion. Jefferson had a very unique view of religion, which is what led him to write the Jefferson Bible. The Jefferson Bible was actually created because of conversations he was having with Rush, because he believed in Christianity, but he did not believe in miracles. And he believed that the story of Jesus should be told without any embellishment. And he and Rush were talking about this from the time they were together in Philadelphia. And after Rush died, Adams said to Jefferson, you promised Rush you were going to do this. You know, you promised Rush you were going to write something about your religious beliefs. And that is why the Jefferson Bible was created. So the interaction with these guys is so interesting. But you don't get to know about it because it's all hidden. The letters all go back to them. This is Rush's son, Richard. He actually goes through the autobiography and crosses stuff out, thinking maybe there's can find enough of it they can publish that won't get anybody in trouble. So this is at the Philosophical Society. You can see the lines he crossed out. These are Richard Rush's pencil marks of the stuff that shouldn't be in the autobiography. They eventually don't publish it at all. And Adams leans on them and he says, you know, I know that somebody, I can't think of anything more patriotic than a biography of Rush, but I shudder at the thought because I know my letters are going to be in it. And so the letters just disappeared. And they weren't known for years and years and years. The Biddles married into the Rush family. And in the late 1800s, Alexander Biddle decided that he would take some of the edited letters and the edited autobiography and make a copy of them for the family. These are the books. They made 50 copies of each. They were just for Biddles and just for Rushes. No historian saw them. And they published just for the family the edited version of the autobiography. People kept wondering, why isn't Rush famous? Why aren't people paying attention to him? The American Medical Association built a statue to him, but there's no statue of Rush in Philadelphia. This statue to him is in Washington. They built it as the first doctor to be honored in Washington, showed that doctors mattered in medicine. Rush's story became more and more obscure because all the best stuff was hidden. And then in 1943, Alexander Biddle's last living kid died, and all the stuff they were hiding went to auction. These are the auction books. There were three separate auctions, but there were 900 lots. This brought in almost $100,000 in 1943 money. And this is like the biggest haul of Revolutionary period letters, signer letters, Rush's autobiography, all this stuff, all came into the market at the same time. Some of it has never been seen since. Some of it got published. These are the two Benjamin Rush letters books that came out in 1951. This is his autobiography and some of his date books that were published in 1948. There's been no other original publishing of Benjamin Rush's work since. Benjamin Rush scholarship stopped in 1951. It's ridiculous. It's one of the last great periods of writing about the revolution that we have not dug into. I mean, I did a little bit of it, but believe me, I didn't have the time or the energy to do what historians should be doing with Rush's story. Rush knew he was going to get screwed by history, but that maybe it would come back around. He wrote this not long before he died. The most acceptable men in practical society have been those who have never shocked their contemporaries by opposing popular or common opinions. Men of opposite characters, like objects placed too near the eye, are seldom seen distinctly by the age in which they live. They must content themselves with the prospect of being useful to the distant and more enlightened generations, that's you, which are to follow them. Please learn more about Benjamin Rush. We're actually building a Benjamin Rush portal at the University of Pennsylvania so you can read all of his writings in the original writing. We've been doing this with Penn Libraries. And if you are interested in this talk or interested in other talks about Benjamin Rush, please recommend them to people. You can find me at stephenfried.com and find my lecture agent as well. Thank you very much for your attention. And I'm happy to take questions.
Stephen, thank you. Can you hear me? Yes. Thank you very much. I think we have time for just a couple of questions. Do we have questions? Yes.
Going to be online, is that true?
Yeah, so this lecture is posted on the Legacy Foundation YouTube page. Just type in.
You want to watch it again right now?
You can watch it on Union League Legacy Foundation. Just type that in and you'll go right to almost all of our lectures, which now I think are around 90, are on our YouTube page. Yes.
Was there a relationship between Thomas Bond and Rush at the Philadelphia?
Sure. Well, Bond was much older than Rush. Bond was the original founder of Pennsylvania Hospital with Benjamin Franklin in the 1750s. One of the most challenging parts of doing history is to remind yourself how old people are, right? Because our teachers just smush everything together like everybody's the same age, they come from the same time. So you got to remember that. When this time was happening, Bond was an old doctor. In fact, Rush took over the care of the mentally ill from Bond, who had been obviously one of the most famous doctors in Philadelphia. And Franklin was really old. When Franklin came back during the period when Rush made the Pennsylvania delegation include him in the Constitution writing. They weren't going to include him because he basically couldn't walk. They had to carry him over every day. So Rush was trying to do the right thing for his elder. But it's really hard, and you always have to remember how old people were. So sure, Rush knew Bond, but Bond was like an old doctor. Rush did, we were actually captured. Rush's first case when he came back was a very famous, well-known shipman who was best friends with John Dickinson, who was manic and didn't believe that he was mentally ill. And all the top doctors in the city treated him, including young Rush was asked to join that, and Bond was one of the doctors who was involved with that. So sure, he knew Bond, but Bond was like old enough to be his grandfather.
So I think what we're going to do.
Get another question back there. No. Wait,
do you have a Jack? One last question. And then any other questions, you'll have to buy a book in the back for it.
Can you talk a little bit about the Frankfurt?
Can I talk a little bit?
Can you
really?
Talk briefly about the Frankfurt advice, which happened not too far from here, where Rush advised. Adams, which led to the strategy for the whole revolutionary movement?
Absolutely. So the Frankfurt advice is a moment that comes up twice in the telling of the country. And it actually is much more elaborated on in these later letters that we talk about than it was originally. So what happened was when the Massachusetts delegation came for the First Continental Congress, they met with the Sons of Liberty of Pennsylvania, who were involved with this mostly because they had been involved with the Tea Party. So the proclamation that led to the Boston Tea Party was written by Rush. It was written for Philadelphia, and Boston used it as well. So they were meeting the Sons of Liberty for the first time. The only person who was there who wasn't a delegate to the meeting was Rush. And Rush he talked a lot, he commandeered Adams, and he was very confrontational, and people thought very bold and a little bit obnoxious, because he said, look, I know you guys from Massachusetts think you're gonna be in charge of everything, because you got killed first. But I'm telling you that if you don't let Virginia have the lead, there will be no country. And of course, they all thought this was ridiculous. And of course, especially ridiculous that this 28-year-old doctor who no one had ever heard of was not only telling them about this when they were having drinks here, but then when Adams gets in his carriage to go back down, Rush figures out how to get into Adams's carriage. And keep talking at him the entire time they're going down to Philadelphia. So it's interesting that Adams describes Rush as being a guy who like talks too much. I don't know what he's talking about. He was happy to go to Rush's house because Rush served really good food. Because basically these guys were, they stayed at people's houses and Rush has always had good melons, he said. But it was only years later, interestingly, that when Adams wrote about this, even after Rush died, he said, it took me this long to realize that if Rush had not said this, even though we thought he was probably wrong, that that was, in fact, the advice that changed everything. Because if we had gone down there and said, look, I mean, they were the only ones who'd been shot at by British people. So they could have reasonably said, we should be running this revolution. We're the only ones who've gotten killed. But the balance between the North and the South was something that only somebody who came from the middle, like Rush. So Rush was, he was brash. He didn't always take care to be, as friendly as he should be. But he was bursting with ideas, and he really needed them to get across. And the advice is really interesting because there are two or three iterations of it in Adams's writing. He writes about it early on, and then he writes about it again in a much more appreciative way. In this correspondence that Rush sort of encouraged. He writes this, by the way, long after Rush died. So I don't know if he ever told, we don't know if he ever told Rush this to his face. It would have been nice if he did. I guess in the HBO version, they can just make it up. But it's actually really profound, and it gives you the idea, you know, Rush didn't run for office. You know, he was in the Continental Congress for a short period of time. His impact in the American Revolution is really fascinating because he was just an advisor to everybody. He was a public writer. He put these ideas out there himself, but he also saw the world in a different way. I mean, a lot of the founding fathers were lawyers and business people. And Rush saw the American Revolution through health. He saw it through the eyes of a doctor. So a lot of these guys thought, okay, we'll pass a law and then that'll be fixed. You know, and you can see the folly of that. But Rush was a doctor. He understood that things didn't get changed just because you recognized a problem. So his medical point of view into the entire American experience is really interesting, and I think it's part of the reason why everybody came away, even the people who disagreed with him, thinking that his ideas were really valuable. And you especially, it's important because he was not an elected official. No one had to listen to him. I mean, he was a lot of people's doctors, but he did not seek public office that way. So the fact that he had all this power as a writer, as a private writer, just because of the power of his words, is actually what's quite interesting.
Stephen, thank you so much. A wonderful, wonderful talk.
Thank you very
much. Thank you.
Be signing books in the back,
and you
right
may ask
now.
All the questions you want if you buy a book
yes.
in the back, and I hope you will.
You can
thank
ask
you
questions
very much.
Without buying a
thank
book,
you,
but it's better.
Thank you, Stephen. And we'll see you. I hope September 14th, and then I believe our next program is September 28th with General Jack Keane. Thank you again. Have a great evening.